let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Sing out. Let it rain. Let it.
Thank you, Father, for giving us this day. Thank you for all the wonderful things that you have done in our lives, in our families, in your church, in all the nations of the world. Thank you for this television station, RTM. Thank you for all the staffs. Thank you for our father in the region. Thank you for our mommy. Thank you for Daddy Adeboye. Thank you for Mommy Folu Adeboye. Thank you for all our fathers in the faith. Thank you for your word. Most importantly, Lord, thank you for giving us your son Jesus, who died so that we may live. May your name be praised forever in the name of Jesus. Eternal Father, we are here this morning to look closely, intently into your word so that we can be built up through your word. Holy Spirit, come and help us. I surrender myself unto you. Take control now in the name of Jesus. At the end of today's teaching, let your name be glorified. Let Jesus be revealed. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' glorious name, I have prayed. Amen. Once again, I want to say good morning, and you are welcome to RTM Studio, where we examine our daily devotionals from the table of our Father in the Law, the servant of Most High, Daddy Adeboye. So we are here to examine the Word of God once again. Today is Tuesday, August 27th. Tuesday, August 27th. And we shall be examining the Word of God together. And it's my pleasure coming your way again. Praise be the name of the Lord. So today we are looking at have faith in God. Have faith in God. So the subject of faith is very powerful, very broad, that every time I'm not sure that you can know everything about faith. You know, revelation is progressive, and we want to see faith in another dimension today. And the topic says, have faith in God. Have faith in God. Some have faith in their boss. Some have faith in one baba in one corner. Some have faith in whatever. But we are advised to have faith in God. Let's go straight to the word of God. Psalm 125 verse 1. That is our memory verse. Psalm 125 verse 1. That is our memory verse. It says, they that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abided forever. They will abide forever. They that trust in the Lord shall be as Mount Zion, which cannot be removed, but abided forever. And let's go straight to our Bible text, which is Mark chapter 11. Mark chapter 11, verse 12 to 14. And that's the same Mark 11, 20 to 24. But let's first of all see 12 to 14. Mark 11, 12 to 14. I read. It says, now the next day, when they had come from Bethany, he was hungry. Who was hungry here? Jesus. He was hungry. And seeing from afar a fig tree having leaves, he went to see if perhaps he will find something on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season of the figs. In response, Jesus said to it, Let no one eat fruit from you ever again. And the disciple heard it. Now, the question is, why would Jesus curse the fig tree? Don't forget, Scripture says it was not the time for the fig tree to bring forth its fruit. So then, why would Jesus now curse the tree when it was not the time for that tree? It's like you are expecting to have mango when it was not season for the mango. And you go to mango tree and you find none and you curse the mango tree. Amen. So, why would Jesus curse that tree? Yeah? Jesus is the maker, the author and finisher of everything. And he knows why he cursed that fig tree. Let's also read that same Mark 11, 20 to 24 says, now in the morning, as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dry off from the root. That was the fig tree that Jesus cursed a day before. And Peter, remembering, said to him, Rabbi, meaning teacher, look, this fig tree which we cursed was withered away. As withered away. So Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. Have faith in God. Now, we now see the reason why Jesus cursed that fig tree. It may not be because Jesus was so desperate to eat, or he was angry because there was no food, or I'm also of opinion that he didn't curse that tree because there was no fruit on it, but he was trying to teach the disciples the subject of faith, that if you have faith in God, this same thing I did to this fig tree, you can do it. Because naturally, I'm of opinion that there was no reason for Jesus to curse that fig tree. Amen. Because the Bible also affirmed it, that it was not the time for a fig tree to bring forth fruit. And Jesus got there and he saw no fruit and he cursed the tree. Now, when Peter reminded him, look at his response. Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. For surely I say to you, whoever say to this mountain, meaning that if you have faith in God, this thing I did to this fig tree, you also can do the same thing, even more than that. Praise be the name of the Lord. If he has not done that to that fig tree, and he's tried to explain to the disciple that I can curse a tree and it will die the following day, I am sure they may not believe him. It is not impossible that they may not believe him. But Jesus did it for them to know. He did it for them to see that with God, all things are possible. With God, all things are possible. Praise be the name of the Lord. With God, all things are possible. Hallelujah. Amen. So let's go on. Today, Bible reading narrates a story that demonstrates faith in action. It demonstrates faith in action and teaches what faith can do for those who live by it. Those who live by faith. Having declared to us in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, that the just shall live by faith. That the just shall live by faith. So our Lord's primary purpose in cursing the fig tree was to show us that living by faith really looks like. He really wanted them to see what living by faith really looked like. If he has been teaching them without showing them, like that, giving them the evidence, they may not believe. I was telling people recently, I said, Jesus could have stayed where he was when he was called that Lazarus was dead and pray, and God will still answer him. But no, he went there with the disciples to teach them that now I've been telling you that it's possible for one to die after 3-4 days and come back to life. So, and he went there and he prayed and he called the spirit of the one that's been buried for 4 days and he came back to life. He was just teaching them the subject of faith. The subject of faith. That was why the first statement Jesus made after Peter drew his attention to the withered fig tree was, have faith in God. Mark chapter 11, verse 22. Have faith in God. He told them, you must have faith in God. Hallelujah. You must have faith in God. Praise the Lord. Now, Jesus further went on to say in Mark 11:23, in Mark 11:23, for verily I say unto you, that whatsoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he said shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he said. Now we can see the reason why Jesus cursed the fig tree. He did not curse that fig tree because he was desperately hungry that, oh no, because people could say, ah, but they said Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega. Why was he so hungry as to curse the fig tree that couldn't bring forth fruit? Of course, the scripture says it was not his time. But he was just teaching the disciple the subject of faith. Praise be the name of the Lord. Living by faith simply means to have faith in God's power and his faithfulness to perform whatever he has promised. If we have faith in God, we should have the confidence to ask him whatever we desire in the place of prayer. Whatever we desire in the place of prayer. The Lord has told us that this is the pathway to receive our heart desires in Mark 11, 24. Mark 11, verse 24. So if you have faith in God, we should also be confident to make declarations based on his word. Based on his word. So we demonstrate our faith by the confessions of our mouth. Psalm 116, verse 10. Psalm 116, verse 10 says, I believe, therefore I have spoken. I believe, therefore I have spoken. God has a way of teaching his children some important subject. Look at the way Jesus was teaching the disciples faith here. I remember. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Many years ago, I'm talking about 14 years ago and thereabouts, after my wedding, we were trusting God for the fruit of the womb. 3 months passed, 6 months passed, a year, and going to 2 years, and I was praying one day. And God said to me by spirit, my son, relax. Your wife will be pregnant of a baby boy, and he gave me the name. I opened my eyes only for me not to see anyone standing behind, because I heard an audible voice. So I quickly picked my pen, I wrote it down, put a date, and put everything there. Afterward, the day break, and a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, I was expecting, my wife to say, oh, darling, this has happened. What we're expecting has happened. I was asking questions, but all to no avail. But to cut the long story short, a few months later, she became pregnant, and I was so glad. And after 4 months, this pregnancy, was threatened. Blood started coming. My wife started seeing blood. And we rushed her to the hospital, and the doctor attended to her. We came back home, and everything was fine. 2 days later, I went to the office, returned to church, and back home. On my returning home, I met my wife on the bed in the pool of blood. And she was crying because she was home alone. There, please, hospital. In fact, when I entered the room and I saw her and I saw the condition, I must confess I was afraid too. But while I was thinking, what do I do? Who do I call? How do we get out to hospital? What God said to me some month before then became real. And I said to myself, if God knows that my wife is going to miscarry this pregnancy, He wouldn't have given me the name. God doesn't operate like that. So my faith grew immediately. The confidence came, and I began to pray. I was praying, I was speaking in tongues. Rebuking the foul spirit around there. So the scripture of when Peter and John was going to the temple and they met a man before at the beautiful gate became so real in my spirit. And then Peter prayed and the man couldn't stand. Peter helped him. So I walked towards my wife and I prayed. I carried her up, put her feet on the ground, and we started praying. To cut the long story short, that was the end of this affliction. The affliction went back to hell. Amen. She never returned. She never go to hospital. Nothing was done except we pray. And God immediately answered our prayer. And I said to my wife, some time ago, I opened the Bible and I show her, God told me that you're going to be pregnant and it's going to be a boy and this is the name. So this foul spirit that is trying to abort this pregnancy is from hell, and he must return back to hell. And to the glory of God, the boy is bouncing, is kicking, and is doing well, and is growing fast today. What am I trying to say here? God has a way of teaching His own whatever He wants us to know. Praise be the name of the Lord. So if we have faith in God, we should also be confident to make declarations based on His word. We demonstrate our faith by the conversion. I've read that. Our Lord expects us to declare what we believe to the mountains and challenge the integrity of His word in our lives instead of crying to Him about them. That is what living by faith is all about. Instead of, God, why me? God, why me? Is to cry to God in faith. And God will answer us. Amen. Amen. A lot of us do not want to develop in our walk with God. We don't want to develop in our walk with God. We just want to remain at the level of babes who expect everything to be done for them instead of taking charge. We can't continue to be a babe in the Lord throughout our life. I just say, come up, Ida. Apostle Paul said, when I was a child, I behaved like a child. But now I'm a son, I'm a man. I behave like a man. You can't remain a babe in Christ forever. We have to grow up. Amen. No wonder the Lord asks this question in Luke 18, verse 8. Luke 18, verse 8 says, nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the head? Shall he find faith on the head? That's a question for us to answer. It is one thing to pray and another thing to believe in practical terms that God will do what you are asking for. Anybody can pray, but to believe in practical terms that you have received what you are asking God for is what is called faith. Though you may not see the physical manifestation, but you believe that without any doubt, this God has answered me. The story was told of a priest who called for a prayer meeting one Sunday afternoon concerning the challenge of drought in a particular town. After the congregation had gathered for the prayer meeting, the priest looked around and said, brethren, you are not ready to pray. The parishioners wondered, what do you mean? This is what we have come to do. Then he asked them, What have you come to do? What have you come to do? The chorus, to pray for rain to fall. He then asked them, where are your umbrellas and raincoats? If you believe that God will answer the prayer you have come to pray, you should have brought your umbrella and raincoats. They went back home and brought their umbrellas and raincoats, and God honored their faith. What a lesson of faith. Beloved, have faith in God. We must have faith in God. We must have faith in His healing power. You must have faith in His word. You must have faith in the Holy Spirit. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. Do you know some people could not speak in tongues because they don't have faith in that? They tell you it's not compulsory. It's not necessary for a child of God. It's not every child of God that should speak in tongues. Can you imagine? Do you know it is not every believer that believes in divine healing? They'll tell you, no, it's not necessary. Why do we have doctor then? Is it not God that gives the doctor the wisdom? We are not disputing that. No, we're not disputing that. But even before you think of going to doctors and whoever, why don't you exercise your faith by laying hands and pray first and see what God will do? Jesus said, we should have faith in God. We must have faith in God. It is so important. And that's why I said in the beginning that the subject of faith cannot be overemphasized. Never. It can never be overemphasized. Praise be the name of the Lord. That is round up by saying, what a lesson of faith. From what the example he gave here, the man of God called the church. There's a drought. There's a need for rain. Let's come together for prayer. And people gathered together for prayers. And he mounted the people and he asked them, are you people ready for prayer? They said, yes. You are not ready yet because you are not showing that you are going to pray with faith. Because if indeed you want to ask for rain and you are so sure that God will answer your prayer, you should have come with umbrella because by the time you will be leaving this place, it will be raining. So how will you return home? Hallelujah. That is what we call practical faith. I mean, practical demonstrations of faith. Practical demonstration of faith. The Lord will help us and build up our faith in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Blessed be your holy name. In Jesus' name, I have prayed. We are asked to sing hymn 8. We are asked to sing hymn 8. Hymn 8 says, my faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary. That's hymn number 8. My faith looks up to thee. Hallelujah. And on final note, we have what we call action point here. That is wrote here. It said, take a practical steps to demonstrate that you believe your prayers to God are being answered. We should take a practical step. If you are trusting God for fruit of the womb and you have prayed, or as you are listening to us now, your faith is being built up, pray now and get some stuff. Maybe if you are expecting a baby boy or baby girl, get some stuff for baby boy. Or if it's a baby girl, get some stuff for baby girl. Amen. Whatever you are trusting God, take a practical step. Believe. Have faith in His word. Have faith in God. And whatever you ask of Him, He will do for you in the name of Jesus. But you may not be able to exercise this faith we are talking about until you are a member of His family, until you give your life to Jesus. So if you are there, my brothers, my sisters, I'm not saying you are a sinner, but I'm saying that your way may not please God. So what you need to do then, come back, forsake those ways, and come to Christ. Praise be the name of the Lord. If you want me to pray with you in 1 minute, just lay your hands in your chest as you pray. Father Lord, all these your children who are listening to us, who are surrendering their life to you now, Father, accept them, wash them by your blood, purify them. Thank you, Father. in Jesus' name. Now you are born again. God bless you. Till I come your way again, I remain your brother, your friend, Pastor Femi Odewale. God bless you.
Sing out. Yeah.